गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट, टुडे वी विल कंटिन्यू आवर डिस्कशन विद बोन ट्यूमर्स। व्हेन अ सेल डिवाइड्स एबनॉर्मली एंड अनकंट्रोलेबली, दे कैन फॉर्म अ मास और लंप ऑफ अ टिश्यू। दिस लंप इज कॉल्ड एज बोन ट्यूमर। बोन एंड सॉफ्ट टिश्यू सार्कोमास आर द ट्यूमर्स डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द मेसेंकाइमल टिश्यू। मेसेंकाइमल टिश्यू इज अ कनेक्टिव टिश्यू। The mesenchyme develops into the tissue of lymphatic and circulatory system as well as musculoskeletal system, that is bone, muscles and cartilage. Bone tumors are rare. 1% of the all new cancer diagnoses are the bone tumors. The pathoetiology remains unclear in majority of the cases of the bone and soft tissue sarcomas. Certain DNA mutation, that is the change in the DNA sequence during the cell division due to exposing to, say, ionizing radiation, certain chemicals, these are called as mutagens, or it could occur because of some viral infection, or there could be a genetic association. For example, in case of osteosarcoma, 70% of the cases will demonstrate mutation in DNA helices of tumor suppressor gene that promote the apoptosis. Apoptosis, as you all know, is the programmed cell death. Such tumors are more common in patients with Liu-Fraumeni syndrome involving P53 tumor suppressor gene and those with retinoblastoma gene. Similarly, in case of Ewing sarcoma, in 95% of the tumor, they demonstrate the EWS-ETS fusion gene rearrangement. Most commonly, the result of translocation between the chromosome 22 and chromosome 11. This we will discuss in the individual tumor discussion in the next parts. Whenever you are studying the cell cycle, there are certain proto-oncogenes. Proto-oncogenes are the genes that promote the normal cell growth. When mutation occurs, the proto-oncogene are converted into the oncogenes. Oncogene overstimulate the cell growth. Oncogenes and mutated tumor suppressor gene result in the formation at tumor. What are the tumor suppressor genes? The tumor suppressor gene are the genes that promote the apoptosis. Every cell has a program inside it that is decided that when that cell will end. That is called as apoptosis or apoptosis. The ETS family, that is erythroblast transformation specific transcription factor. What is the transcription factor? It is a protein that controls the rate of transcription of genetic information from the DNA to the messenger RNA by binding to specific DNA sequence. Is responsible for cellular differentiation, cell cycle, cell migration and apoptosis. Therefore, mutation will result in deregulation of programmed cell death and disruption of the cell cycle control. So this disruption of the cell cycle control or disruption with the program of apoptosis or cell death results in the excessive cell growth, and this results in a tumor formation. Classification. Tumors of the bone and soft tissue are classified on the basis of the principal cell type by WHO. The tissue diagnosis is essential to predict the natural history and the treatment of the lesion. A benign lesion of the bone is defined that one does not invade the surrounding tissue or spread elsewhere in the body. So, whenever you call a lesion as a benign, by definition it will not invade the surrounding tissue, by definition it will not metastasize. Most benign tumors of the bone have limited capacity of the recurrence, and even if the recurrence occur, the recurrence is non-destructive. The surgical resection often curative. Benign lesion can be latent or inactive. So For example, what I mean by latent or inactive lesion, such as if a bone has a non-ossifying fibroma, or which are latent lesion, or there can be a lesion in the bone which is active, which has a high risk of the recurrence after, even after the treatment. For example, aneurysmal brain cyst. Non-ossifying fibroma is a benign tumor that mainly consists of fibrous tissue. Usually, the occurs in the femur and the tibia. Usually, it produces no symptoms and it may resolve by itself and it never spreads. An aneurysmal bone cyst is a benign blood-filled lesion in the bone that tend to expand and grow. Though it is called a cyst, it is true benign bone tumor surrounded by a thin wall of bone. Usually, whenever there is a fluid-filled cavity, we call it as a cyst. Though this is labeled as aneurysmal bone cyst, it is a bone tumor surrounded by a thin rim of bone. Aneurysmal bone cyst can occur in any bone. Here, we can see the aneurysmal bone cyst occurring in the distal end of the tibia. As you can see, there is a metaphyseal lesion. Lesion is lytic with expansion of the cortex and thinning of the cortices of the tibia. Here you can make out the cortex is thinned out. So now this is a non-ossified fibroma. This is also is lesion is located in the distal tibiofibular joint, distal tibia. It is in the metaphyseal region, but it is a well demarcated lesion. You can make out the line of demarcation between the tumor and the normal bone. Intermediate or locally aggressive lesion of the bone. They can destroy the bone and the surrounding tissue. For example, osteoblastoma. What is osteoblastoma? Osteoblastoma is an uncommon bone forming primary neoplasm of the bone. So, as we know, bone is basically made up of three types of cells. There are osteoblasts that are forming bone, osteoclasts which are resorbing the bone, and there are fibroblasts. So, osteoblastoma is a bone forming and primary neoplasm. Clinically and histologically it is similar to osteoid osteoma. Sometimes it is also called as giant osteoid osteoma. These lesions often recur and are associated with infiltrative and locally destructive growth pattern. What do you mean by infiltration? When the tumor cell infiltrate or invades into normal surrounding tissue or causes the destruction of the surrounding tissue, it is called as infiltrative or destructive pattern of the growth. En bloc resection is required for the complete removal of the tumor. The en bloc resection, surgeon removes the tumor mass entirely surrounded by a continuous layer of a healthy tissue along with the tumor. Here you can see the proximal femur of a child. Why I say child? Because epiphyseal or growth plate, you can see the trochanter is not fused and there is a lytic lesion in the metaphysis of the proximal femur. This is called as osteoblastoma. Intermediate or rarely metastasizing lesions. They are often behave in similar way to the locally aggressive lesion, but occasionally demonstrate ability to spread distant site. The risk of such spread is less than 2%, often non-fatal and not reliably predictable by histological appearance. Example, giant cell tumor of the bone. So these tumors have capacity of distant spread. Malignant tumor. The malignant tumors are truly aggressive with potential for both local extension as well as metastasis to the distant site. The aggressiveness of the tumor is defined by histological grade. Whenever you label a tumor as a malignant, it must have the two basic characteristics. It must be locally aggressive, that is, it has a capacity to extend into surrounding tissue and it has a capacity to spread the distant organ. When you are talking about the grade, histological grade, when you are talking about the low grade tumor, for example, chordoma, Chordoma is a rare type of slow-growing malignant tumor which commonly occurs in the sacrum, cervical spine or brain stem. What we call it as the axial skeleton. For example, second is the paraosteal osteosarcoma. They have a slow rate of growth. Metastases are less common, but metastases can arise many years after the initial diagnosis. So this type of tumors that have low grade have a better prognosis. Here you can see the MRI of the sacrum. This is fifth lumbar vertebra. This is the lumbosacral disc. You can very well make out the chordoma. Chordoma is a tumor arising from the notochordal tissue, remnants of the notochordal tissue in the body. High-grade tumors have very high risk of metastasizing, 20 to 100%. They are locally invasive. Example, Ewing sarcoma and osteosarcoma. We will discuss these two tumors in detail because these are most common tumors and mostly they are asked in the exam as a long question or the short notes. Then what is the grade? Grade is based on the cellularity and the nuclear features of the cell. Higher the grade, more the cellular is the tumor. Now we will discuss the WHO classification of the bone tumor. As I have already told, bone is made up of osteogenic cell as well as cartilage cell. It also contains fibroblasts. It also contains giant cell, notochordal cell. It also contains blood vessels. It also contains myocytes, that is muscles, and it also contains lipogenetic, that is lipid cell, fat cells. So when an osteoblast is producing the tumor, the cell of origin of is osteogenic, they are called as osteogenic tumor. If it is benign, it is called as osteoid osteoma. If it is intermediate lesion, it is called as osteoblastoma. And if it is malignant, you label it as a osteosarcoma. When cell of origin is a cartilage cell, then we label it as a chondrogenic tumor. Examples of the benign chondrogenic tumors are enchondromas, osteochondromas, periosteal chondromas and synovial chondroma. Examples of chondrogenic intermediate tumors is chondroblastoma. And examples of malignant chondrogenic tumor is chondrosarcoma, clear cell chondrosarcoma, dedifferentiated chondrosarcoma and mesenchymal chondrosarcoma. So here the cell of origin is cartilage cell. Then we have described the benign lesion arising from the cartilage cell. Then we have described intermediate lesion arising from the cartilage cell and malignant lesion arising from the cartilage cell. So for the fibrous cells, that is fibrous tissue, there are no benign lesion, but intermediate lesions are desmoplastic fibroma and malignant lesion are fibrosarcoma. And giant cell rich tumor are giant cell tumor and malignant giant cell tumor. So notochordal tumor, as we have already discussed, that it can be a benign notochordal tumor or it can be a chordoma, sacral chordoma. Sacral chordoma is a low grade tumor, but it is a malignant tumor. So you can get a vascular, that is tumor arising from the blood vessels. Every bone has a arterial supply as well as venous supply. So arteries and veins and those tissue can get malignant transformation. So such type of tumor, if it is benign, you call it as a hemangioma. Then if it is intermediate, we call it as epithelioid hemangioma. If it becomes malignant, then it is labeled as angiosarcoma, epithelioid angiosarcoma. Then skeletal muscle, that is myogenic tumors, are leiomyoma of the bone and leiomyosarcoma of the bone. Then lipoma of the bone and liposarcoma of the bone are arising from the fat tissue. Then we will discuss about some undefined tumor. Undefined tumors, if they are benign, when they cannot be categorized into some osteogenic, chondrogenic or fibrogenic origin, then for example simple bone cyst, fibrous dysplasia and osteofibrous dysplasia. Intermediate lesion in this category is aneurysmal bone cyst, then histiocytosis X, and malignant lesion in undefined categories is Ewing sarcoma, adamantinoma. Adamantinoma is a common lesion occurring in the diaphysis of the tibia. Undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcomas of the bone. Now we'll discuss basic difference. Why we call it as a sarcoma? Whenever embryonic development is occurring, the tissue is divided into ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm. Whenever ectoderm or endoderm, say for example skin, carcinoma arises from the cancer arising in the squamous cell of the skin is called as squamous cell carcinoma. If you have pancreatic cancer, you will label it as a carcinoma, gastric carcinoma. Then, but if the tumor is arising from the bone, muscle, then it is labeled as a sarcoma. So these are the mesodermal tumor. Why I am stressing on all this classification of benign, intermediate and malignant? Because most of the time you are in examination ask about the multiple choice question and you have to diagnose the thing because of cell of origin and you have to answer it accordingly. So staging, what do you mean by staging? Staging is the process to ascertain the extent of the tumor both locally and distantly. The most bone and soft tissue sarcoma metastasizes via the bloodstream. The lungs are the most common site of metastasis. Other sites that may include are bone, other bones in the body, lymph nodes, liver and other soft tissue location. Staging system is useful for communicating and the planning of the treatment and predicting the prognosis. As a doctor, we should know what is the stage of the cancer so that we are communicating with the patient, communicating with the relative, communicating with the other specialists, so we can give them the basic idea what would be or what kind of the treatment will be required and what will be the prognosis of the patient. Then what is the grading? Grade of the tumor is measure of its aggressiveness. Grading is based on the nuclear atypia, the degree of loss of structural differentiation and pleomorphism. What is pleomorphism? Pleomorphism is the variation in size and shape, and nuclear hyperchromasia, that is the increased nuclear staining. So grading is based on the histology. So we will discuss about the Enneking system. This is developed as a reference to aid the surgical resection of the primary tumors of the bone. Enneking system is classified as the tumors into high grade and low grade. Before this, I would like to say why I have insisted a primary tumor. Primary tumor is a tumor arising de novo in the bone. And secondary bone tumor, if a tumor is arising in some other part of the body and coming to bone, then we label it as a secondary tumor. Enneking system classifies the tumor into high grade or low grade, whether metastasis present or whether metastasis are absent, and whether tumor has grown out of the compartment or we remain confined to the compartment. So what do you mean by a compartment? A compartment is an enclosed tissue space such as bone and joint space or muscle group confined by its facial envelope. As we have studied in the anatomy, in the forearm we have a flexor compartment, we have extensor compartment, in the thigh we have an adductor compartment, we have a compartment, quadriceps as a compartment, we have a lateral part. So in the leg also we have various compartments. So when tumor is confined to that compartment, or whether it has crossed the boundary of that compartment is taken into consideration in the Enneking system. So Enneking system classifies the tumor as stage 1A, that is low grade intracompartmental tumor. Stage 1B, low grade extracompartmental. So tumor is of the low grade. In first type it is confined to the compartment and it has crossed the compartment. In stage 2 it is high grade intracompartmental, and stage 2B it high grade extra. Anything up above with metastasis is called as stage 3. So in this diagram you can see the distal end of the femur. Red is the tumor. So black is the pseudocapsule of the tumor, and the yellow is the reactive zone. Reactive zone, when a tumor is growing, the tumor mass compresses the normal tissue or healthy tissue of the body. That healthy tissue is called as reactive zone. So this is the distal femur. Here you can see the tumor. This is intracompartmental low grade tumor. As you know, every bone has a cortex and a bone marrow. When there is a break in the cortex and tumor extend into surrounding soft tissue, then this tumor become the extracompartmental tissue. So here you can see the tumor, you can see that it's pseudocapsule, and this brown is the muscle. Tumor is extending into surrounding muscle. In this diagram, you can see tumor is gone into the lung, or tumor is gone into the pelvis, some other body tissue. This is called as metastasis. So in 2A, tumor is high grade, but it is limited to the compartment. In 2B, tumor is high grade, but it is extending to soft tissue, surrounding soft tissue. And in stage 3, tumor is extending to distant part. Distant part could be anything like lungs. Then you have a TNM classification, tumor node metastasis system. Why I am stressing all these things? Because this will help you to understand the cancers in the bone and the soft tissue, and you will be able to communicate with patients and your colleagues freely. The TNM classification is dealing with the stages. Here we have a 4 stages. Previously we discussed the tumor into the 3 stages. Here stage 1 is low grade, small, without any metastasis. Low grade, large tumors, no metastasis. So there is a difference in only size. So when tumor is small and tumor is large. In second stage, that is intermediate grade or high grade, there is no metastasis. So first and second stage, there is no metastasis. So only grading is high. So this is based on the histology of the tumor. And the stage 3 is high grade, large lesion without metastasis. And stage 4, anything of the above with metastasis. So T is the tumor, N is the node, and M is the metastasis. Most of the bone tumor do not metastasize via the lymphatic system. They mainly metastasize via the bloodstream. So this is a tumor. Tumor is small, tumor is intermediate size, and tumor is very large. So whenever there is a lymph node, you should look for a local node and distant node. Whether tumor has spread to local node or tumor has gone to the distant node. In case of metastasis, here you can see this is the lung, this is the bone, and this is the liver. Here tumor has spread to the liver, for example. Now here you can see the tumor has spread to lungs, it has spread to liver, and it has spread to vertebra also. There are multiple metastases. So this become a high grade or stage 4. So now we will discuss about the clinical presentation. In the bone tumors, most of the time the diagnosis is delayed. Why diagnosis is delayed? Because doctor don't suspect. So doctors treating or attending the patient with the musculoskeletal problem must have high index of suspicion for the malignancy. Patient may present with pain, mass, or abnormal radiological finding. So he has say come to a doctor for some other problem, and x-ray is taken and you find something or some lesion in the bone. This is a unrelated problem. This sometimes are called as incidental presentation. And sometime in a region like pelvis, tumor may attain a very large size prior to patient noticing the tumor or coming or presenting or reporting that problem to the doctor. Initially patient may have pain that is related to the activity, but as the disease advances, later the pain occurs even at the rest, and in certain cases even you get a night pain. If the lesion is large enough to weaken the bone, patient may present with a pathological fracture. As you all know, when bone fractures because of trauma, we label it as a traumatic fracture. And whenever there is a fracture in the bone, whenever they say osteoporosis, then deficient mineralization, and then some lesion in the bone or some disease process going on in the bone, and that is weakening the bone and that is causing the fracture, it is called as pathological fracture. So sometime a patient with a bone tumor can present to you with a pathological fracture. Patient with the soft tissue tumor rarely complained of the pain, they complained of a mass. Suppose a patient is getting a tumor from the nerve or nerve sheath, they will have a pain and the neurological symptoms. Physical examination. The physical examination should include the patient's general health and part in question. So mass should be measured for its location, shape, consistency, mobility, tenderness, local temperature, change with position should be noted. So whenever you are clinically examining a case of a bone tumor, what you should do, you should measure the dimension. You should see the vertical dimension, transverse dimension, where it is located. Why location is important? So you can get a definite idea whether it is in the metaphyseal region, it is in the diaphysis, or whether it is in the epiphysis. You should look for the mobility. So with mobility you can see the fixity to bone or fixity to muscle. Then you should look for the tenderness and local temperature. Increased local temperature will indicate about the vascularity. If tumor is highly vascular, temperature will be more. If tumor is less vascular, it won't give any changes in the temperature. The changes with the position should also be noted. Then you should note for atrophy of the surrounding musculature. Then one should look for distal neurovascular deficit, whether the tumor is pressing on the any surrounding nerve or vessel and that is causing neurological symptom or vascular symptom. Cafe olet spot. As you know, in neurofibromatosis you can get a cafe olet spot, or cutaneous hemangioma provide the diagnostic clue. Rapidity of enlargement of the mass suggests the malignant lesion. Suppose you have a patient, say 17-year-old man, and he says in last 2 months the tumor has expanded to present size, then you have a suspicion it is a rapidly growing tumor, so it is a malignant tumor. So, and if patient gives the history, there is a tumor, say, and it has been there since last, say 4-5 years, and it has not changed the size or its shape, and it is not producing a much symptom, then what comes in our mind is it is probably a benign lesion. So what I want to insist, all lesion measuring more than 5 cm should be considered as a sarcoma unless and until proven otherwise. This is the main intention. So whenever you see a patient which has a lesion more than 5 cm, unless proven otherwise, you should suspect it as a sarcoma, and you should investigate in that line. So what are the investigation in the bone tumor? Most of the other tumors require variety of the investigation, but in case of bone tumor there is one peculiarity. Conventional x-ray is very good for providing useful diagnostic information for evaluation of the bony lesion. Often patient's age and plain x-ray finding are sufficient to arrive at the specific diagnosis. Whenever you are seeing an x-ray of a patient with a bony lesion or bone tumor, what questions you should ask while assessing the x-rays? So first question you should come to mind is what is the age of the patient, then which bone is affected, then where in the bone lesion is, by this what I mean, every bone as we know is divided into epiphyses. Epiphysis is the end of the bone. Epiphysis is covered by articular cartilage. Then every bone has a metaphysis and a diaphysis. Diaphysis is also called as a shaft. So whenever you are seeing in the x-ray, you should see whether the lesion is in the epiphysis, whether in the diaphysis, whether in the metaphysis. Then what lesion is doing to bone? By asking this, what we are meaning, we should ask whether lesion is osteolytic. Osteolytic lesion produces the bone destruction, or whether osteoblastic, whenever lesion is producing new bone, then we call this as a osteoblastic lesion. And whenever lesion is doing both, when lesion is causing destruction also and lesion is causing the new bone formation also, then we called it as a mixed lesion. Then you should look for what bone is doing in response. So what bone is doing in response, what will be the bone doing in response to the tumor? There will be a periosteal reaction. It will be an attempt of the bone to reconsider or strengthen the weakened bone. So you should look for whether there is a periosteal reaction. Then you should look for whether there is an associated mass. Then you should look for a nature of the matrix, whether it is osteoid, whether it is chondroid, whether it is a fibroid. Then one must look for whether the lesion is solitary or there are multiple lesions. So you should ask whether the lesion is single or there are multiple lesions. So these important, these, whenever you are looking at the x-ray of a patient with a bone tumor, these questions should come into the mind. If you systematically analyze and ask the question to yourself about the these questions, then probably with x-ray finding and the age of the patient, you are highly likely to reach the correct diagnosis in that case. So here you can see the epiphysis, here see metaphysis, and here is the diaphysis. So I have labeled, see, infection is common in epiphysis, okay, in both case, above the 30 and patient is above 30 and below 30, you can get infection in the epiphysis. So in a younger age group, epiphyseal region is a chondroblastoma, and in adults, epiphyseal region is a giant cell tumor. Then metaphysis, in younger age group, you can get osteosarcoma, you can get aneurysmal bone cyst, or you can get enchondroma. Then in adults also, you can get enchondroma or chondrosarcoma in the metaphysis. So when your lesion is in the metaphysis, you should look for whether it is central lesion or whether it is eccentric lesion. Central lesion is confined to the central region, and when lesion is located in the periphery of the bone, it is called as eccentric lesion. So osteosarcoma, as you have seen, it is an eccentric lesion, and enchondroma is a central lesion. Then the here Ewing's tumor or eosinophilic granuloma, these are the diaphyseal lesion in the younger age group, and metastasis or myeloma or the lymphoma are the diaphyseal lesion in the adult group. So lesion can be well defined, lesion can be ill defined, lesion can be sclerotic. So you know the age of the patient, you know the x-ray. So in all ages, infection is common. So infection will always remain a differential diagnosis in whenever you are studying a tumor case. So patient is say between 0 to 10 years, and you have a well-defined lesion. It could be eosinophilic granuloma, it could be simple bone cyst. In same age group, if you have a ill-defined lesion, here you can make out, here is a clear-cut boundary of the tumor and here is the surrounding normal tissue. Here you cannot demarcate which one is the tumor and which one is the normal tissue. Okay, so this is called as ill-defined lesion. Ill-defined lesion are likely to be malignant, and well-defined lesion are likely to be benign. So, ill-defined lesion in this age group can be Ewing sarcoma, osteosarcoma, or can be leukemia. Then, sclerotic lesion. Here you can see the dense bone formation. So, here is more osteoblastic activity. There is more calcium deposition. And therefore, lesion is appearing bright. For example, osteosarcoma. Say, patient is of 10 to 20 years. And lesion is well defined. What it could be? It could be non-ossifying fibroma, then fibrous dysplasia, simple bone cyst, aneurysmal bone cyst, chondroblastoma. And if it is an ill-defined lesion, it could be Ewing sarcoma. If it is eosinophilic granuloma, it could be osteosarcoma. And if it is a sclerotic lesion in the same age group, it could be fibrous dysplasia, it could be osteosarcoma, it could be osteoid osteoma, it could be osteostoma. If a patient is coming in between 20 to 40, you can get a well-defined lesion in giant cell tumor, enchondroma, then osteoblastoma. You can get ill-defined in a giant cell tumor, and sclerotic lesion is a enchondroma, osteocoma, bone island. Why I am insisting? Most of the time you will get a X-ray and you will get a multiple choice. So in MCQ you have to see the X-ray, whether it is well defined lesion, whether in the diaphysis, whether in the metaphysis, and then you have to come to probable conclusion. If patient is above 40, metastasis, myeloma or GOD, then ill-defined lesion could be metastasis, myeloma or chondrosarcoma, high grade, and metastasis and bone island. So, certain radiological characteristic features you should know. So, fibrous dysplasia produces the ground glass appearance. Giant cell tumor and adamantinoma gives a soap bubble appearance. Non-homogeneous calcification or punctate or popcorn or comma shaped or stipple calcification indicate the cartilage, and homogeneous calcification indicate the osteogenic sarcoma. So these appearance on the X-ray, if it is a ground glass, you can assume that it is arising from the fibrous tissue or it is fibrous dysplasia. So whenever you have a epiphyseal lesion before the physeal closure, that is in the young children, it will most likely to be chondroblastoma. After the physeal closure, in adults, it is likely to be giant cell tumor or clear cell chondrosarcoma. If you get a diaphyseal lesion, it could be Ewing sarcoma, lymphoma, fibrous dysplasia or adamantinoma. So, what is the differential diagnosis for the lesions in the spine? If patient is older than 40 years, most commonest thing is the metastasis, multiple myeloma, hemangioma, and as we have already discussed, there can be a chordoma. So you have a patient, tumor in the spine, age is more than 40 years, what could be the possibility? Possibility will be metastasis, multiple myeloma, hemangioma, and chordoma. If you have a younger patient is less than 30, and lesion is in the vertebral body. As you all know, the vertebra is divided into body, then lamina, transverse process, spinous process, and the neural element. These are the vertebral body and this is the posterior element. These are the articular facets, superior articular and inferior articular. If the lesion is in the vertebral body, what it could be? It could be histiocytosis, it could be hemangioma. If lesion is in the posterior element, say lamina, pedicle, transverse process, spinous process, it could be osteoid osteoma, it could be osteoblastoma, it could be a aneurysmal bone cyst. Then other investigation in continuation is radionuclide scanning. What is done in radionuclide scanning? You inject a radio label a substance intravenously, then substance is taken up by the body and you have a gamma camera. The gamma camera will record in which tissue the radionuclide tissue has been taken up. For example, see in technetium-99 scan, This is helpful in finding small tumor like osteodysostoma. It can be useful for detecting the skip lesions, and it can be also useful for looking for the evidence of the metastasis. So radionuclide scan is also an important investigation. Now we should discuss about the what is satellite lesion and what is skip lesion. So satellite lesion is the lesion distant from the tumor but within the reactive zone of the tumor. Satellite lesion is the lesion distant from the tumor but within the reactive zone. And skip lesion is the lesion outside the reactive zone of the tumor but within in the same bone. So this is a femur. You can see the red bone tumor, and this is the surrounding reactive zone of the tumor. Here you can see the satellite lesion, and here you can see the skip lesion. When we were learning, say 20 years back, the treatment for the bone tumors was amputation. So, but with advancement of the latest investigation modalities like MRI, availability of CT scan and nuclear scan, previously there was high chances of recurrence because we were missing the satellite lesion and the skip lesions, because investigation modalities like MRI were not available widespread. But now with widespread availability of the MRI and nuclear scan and say some positron emission tomography, we can locate this lesion. And what has change in last 20, 23, 25 or 30 years is the survival rate has dramatically increased in the bone tumors. MRI. Why MRI is done? MRI shows the local extent of the tumor. I am not saying that we should go for MRI in every case of bone tumor. See, if you have a clear cut case of exostosis or osteochondroma, and radiologically on X-ray you are sure this is a exostosis, then there is no need to go for MRI. Why MRI is important, why it is advised, that I want to express. MRI, why MRI is done? It is done for the assessment of the tumor spread. The tumor spread can be within the bone, tumor can go to nearby joint, or tumor can spread into the soft tissue. Then MRI will tell you the neurological structures and neurovascular structure, what is the relation of the vascular and neurological structure with the tumor. So whenever you are planning a biopsy or operative removal of the tumor, you should know the position of the nerves and vessels. MRI also will predict and prepare the surgeon for resection of the margin. All primary bone tumors of the bone should be investigated with MRI. A well-defined lesion is likely to be benign. Ill-defined lesion is more likely to be malignant or metastatic. Or lastly, I will say it is vital to assume nothing. Keep an open mind. Bronchus, breast, prostate, kidney, thyroid are also a possible primary site. Whenever you are looking for a bone tumor, or whenever you have a patient with a bone tumor, you should include, or you should always look for specifically the bronchus, breast, prostate, kidney, thyroid to look for the possible primary sites. Then biopsy. Biopsy is the gold standard. It determines the tumor type and the grade. Biopsy track must not contaminate the normal tissue and should be done by the surgeon who will carry out the definitive surgery. These are the general guidelines, general principle. So whenever you are intending from the, whenever you are a principal surgeon, then only you should attempt for the biopsy. It should be from the representative tissue. What I mean by representative tissue, if you are taking a biopsy from a tumor and you miss the tumor and you take some tissue sample from the surrounding tissue, then you will entirely miss the diagnosis, you will entirely miss the grading. So it should be image guided. What you mean by image guided, whenever you are approaching the bone, you should go under either X-ray control, or you have a image intensifier machine in orthopedic theater, that is also called as C-arm, where you can continuously see the bone under the screen and you can see the image of the bone as well as the lesion on the screen, or it could be under the guidance of the CT scan. Complete hemostasis must be achieved. Sample should always be sent for microbiology as well as histology. As I have already said, whenever you are evaluating a case of a bone tumor, most of the time you should always keep in mind is this could be a osteomyelitis or infection. So whenever you are sending the sample, you should send for microbiology as well as histology. This we will discuss in Ewing sarcoma. Ewing sarcoma, most of the time surgeon is suspecting infection and most of the time he is sending the sample to the microbiology for pus and culture, and he forgets to send the sample to histological analysis and he misses the tumor. If there is risk of fracture following the biopsy, bone must be appropriately splinted. So suppose if you are removing a large chunk of tissue from the bone and that can weaken and there is a chance of the pathological fracture, you should protect that part with an appropriate splint. The pathologist reporting the biopsy must have an appropriate level of the experience. This is a Jamshedi needle. Here you can see this is most commonly used for the bone biopsy. Here is the trocar and here is the cannula. Cannula is the passing from the trocar. So with this needle you create a core in the bone and this type of bone tissue is removed with the and subjected to the histopathology. The systemic examination of the patient should include the examination of bronchus, breast, prostate, kidney, thyroid, as they can the possible primary sites. X-ray, MRI, CT chest, CT abdomen, pelvis for occult primary. What do you mean by occult primary? When you don't know which one is the site or from where is the tumor, where the tumor is arising, and you have a lesion in the bone, but you are not sure from where the tumor is coming to this bone, then we call it as a occult primary. Biochemical markers like PSA, that is prostate specific antigen, for example, PSA will be increased in the prostate cancer. Then in multiple myeloma, though it is not a bone tumor, it is arising from the plasma cells. Serum electrophoresis, and in urine you can see the Benjoin protein. Increased serum calcium is seen in case of hyperparathyroidism and increased alkaline phosphatase in Paget disease. You should always do C-reactive protein and ESR to rule out infection. As we know, the CRP is the earliest marker of the inflammation. It rises early and also wanes, and ESR takes more time to rise. Now we will discuss about the general principles of the management of the primary bone tumor. Not every bone tumor requires the surgery. You have to classify whether lesion is latent or lesion is active or lesion is malignant. A latent benign lesion do not require any treatment unless symptomatic. The latent benign lesion do not require any treatment. What they need is the observation and reassurance to the patient. Active benign lesion usually require the intervention to halt the active process of the disease and to allow the healing. This may include biopsy, curettage and bone grafting. Biopsy, here you remove the bit of tissue, then in curettage you remove the tumor and whatever the cavity is there, you fill it with the bone graft. Intermediate lesion, that is the lesion present considerable challenge in the management as recurrence is common. n block removal of the lesion may be required to achieve the local control. Then malignant tumor. Malignant tumors will respond to chemotherapy. Example, osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma. Surgical resection, and they will also require highly specialized radiotherapy. Then the principles of the surgical treatment and definition of the margin. Whenever you are treating a case of a bone tumor, you should know what is the margin. So we will discuss about the margins of the tumor. The treatment goal in a malignant bone tumor is to remove the lesion with minimal risk of local recurrence. So what is our aim of the treatment? We should remove the tumor in total, and we should avoid the chances of the recurrence. Then you should think about limb salvage. Limb salvage is done when following two essential criteria. See, prior to advancement in chemotherapy, radiation and various modalities and various this, amputation was the standard treatment for the bone tumors. Okay, so with advancement in the surgery, chemotherapy and radiation, most of the tumors are treated with combination of all these things, and most limbs are saved. But in order to save the limb, limb salvage is done when following two essential criteria are met. So local control of lesion must be equal to that of amputation, and limb that has been saved must be functional. If it is non-functional limb, there is no purpose in saving the limb. The well-fitted amputated stump with the prosthesis has a better functional significance than a non-functional limb. Wide margin of the surgical resection is the operative goal. Whenever you are operating on the bone tumor, wide margin surgical resection is your goal. Now we will discuss what we mean by the margin of the tumor. Intralesional margin. When the plane of dissection goes directly through the tumor, so you are going dissecting out the tumor by going through the tumor itself. When the surgery involves the malignant mesenchymal tumor and your plane of dissection is intralesional, then there is 100% chances of local recurrence. So this type of procedure is called as debulking of the tumor. Here the plane of dissection grows through the tumor. Then the marginal margin. Line of resection grows through the reactive zone of the tumor. The reactive zone contains inflammatory cell, edema, fibrous tissue, satellite tumor cell. When the malignant tumor are resected, plane of the dissection is through the reactive zone. The local chances of recurrence is 25% to 50%. So, if our dissection is going through the lesion, the chances of recurrence will be 100%. If your plane of dissection is going through the marginal margin or reactive zone, the chances of local recurrence will be 25% to 50%. So, this is a cross section of the thigh, say. Here you can make out the femur. This is the medullary cavity of the femur. This is the neurovascular bundle. So this red is a tumor. This black line is this is tumor mass. This is the reactive zone. So now this will explain what I was telling you. So lesion is this dissection, plane of dissection is going through the tumor. If this is our plane of dissection, the chances of local recurrence will be 100%. So now here you can see our plane of dissection is going through reactive zone. As we have already studied, reactive zone has a satellite lesions, can have. I am not saying it will always have. It could have the satellite lesion, and here the chances of the recurrence will be 25% to 50%. Now this is the wide margin. Wide margin, here you are removing tumor, here you are removing surrounding reactive zone, and here you are also removing the surrounding normal tissue, and you can make out you are not endangering any neurovascular structure, so that you are making the limb viable. You are not endangering the limb. So this is called a wide margin. There is one more margin that is called a radical margin that we will discuss in next slide. A marginal margin may be safe and effective if there is response to preoperative chemotherapy has been explained. Nowadays we give a chemotherapy prior to main surgery. So aim of that chemotherapy is to shrink the tumor. Then because of that chemotherapy, we can instead of going for radical dissection, we can go for more conservative dissection and less risk to the patient of local recurrence, and we can salvage the limb. Wide margin. A wide line of surgical resection is achieved when entire tumor is removed with a cup of normal tissue. The local recurrence rate is below 10%. Such surgical margin is achieved. And what is radical margin? Radical margin is achieved when entire tumor and its compartment, that is all surrounding muscle, surrounding ligament, surrounding connective tissue, are removed. Same is applicable with the amputation. So when amputation, level of amputation is going through the tumor, we'll call as a intralesional amputation on debulking. Here will be 100% chances of local recurrence. When the amputation is going through the reactive zone, it will be a marginal amputation. And when amputation is going in a normal tissue, surrounding normal tissue, then we will call it as a wide amputation. And entire compartment is removed. Say here you have gone to the proximal, up to the proximal joint. Your muscles of origin, insertion, entire facial envelope is removed. That is entire compartment is removed. Then it is called as a, by definition, it is called as a radical amputation. Now this is the most common thing, neoadjuvant and adjuvant therapy. Most of the time in the examiners will ask you about the what is neoadjuvant therapy and what is adjuvant therapy. This I want to make you to clear concept about it. Neoadjuvant therapy is the treatment given as a first step to shrink the tumor before the main treatment, which is usually surgery. So neoadjuvant therapy is the therapy given as a first step to treatment before the main surgery. Okay, so neoadjuvant therapy may include chemotherapy, it may include radiation, or it may include hormone therapy. And what is adjuvant therapy? Adjuvant therapy is often used after the primary treatment. Say you have done a tumor surgery, now you want to prevent the recurrence, then for that you give the adjuvant therapy. So adjuvant therapy is for to prevent the chances of the recurrence of the cancer. In case of osteosarcoma, drug like doxorubicin, cisplatin and hydroxymethotrexate are given in various combination to increase the rate of tumor necrosis. So in that case, prior to surgery you give the chemotherapy with various combination of the this drug. What this drug do? They will cause the necrosis of the tumor cell. So before going or before proceeding for the surgery, most of the tumor cells will be dead. Most of the satellite or scape lesion will be dead, so that whatever local control you will be achieving, that will be more control. So say in because of this, what I have to stress is that because of this thing, the survival rate has dramatically increased. When we were studying, if you are labeling a patient with osteosarcoma, then you as if you are writing a death sentence for that boy or that patient. But now with advancement in the adjuvant therapies, new adjuvant therapies investigation, most these patients are surviving, and they are surviving with mega prosthesis, and they are living their normal life. So your concept about neoadjuvant adjuvant therapy is clear. Now we will discuss about the aim of the chemotherapy. Aim of the chemotherapy is try to the shrink the tumor while also treating the macrometastasis. So what is macrometastasis? Patient without radiologically detectable metastasis is considered to have a macrometastasis. Say, whenever you have a patient with a bone tumor, say metaphyseal lesion in the distal femur, his X-ray chest is normal, CT is normal, his X-ray femur does not show any skip lesion in that femur, but still microscopic metastasis can be present. You should never forget about the micrometastasis. Your chemotherapy is targeted with to tackle this micrometastasis. Then what is radiotherapy? Ewing sarcoma is the radiosensitive tumor, as we all know. This is always asked, which are the tumor radiosensitive, which are the tumor that are chemosensitive in the examination. So you must know the Ewing sarcoma is the radiosensitive tumor. A tumor when it is in some inaccessible site where surgical removal is not possible. Suppose you have very large tumor, when tumor is near to major blood vessel, so surgical approach to that tumor will be difficult, or you may likely endanger that vessel or nerve while trying to remove that tumor. And when there is an advanced local spread and marrow cell tumor like myeloma, lymphoma, these are treated with the radiotherapy. So radiotherapy is indicated in tumors with inaccessible site, when there is a very large size of tumor, when tumor is proximal to major blood vessel, when there is a very advanced spread of the tumor so that the surgical resection is not possible without endangering the patient, then you go for radiation. I think we will conclude up to this. So up to this, if you summarize what we have discussed, basically you should know whether the tumor is benign, whether it is intermediate grade, or whether it is malignant. Then you should be able to differentiate between whether tumor is in the epiphysis, whether it is in the metaphysis, whether tumor is in the diaphysis. Then you should look for the age. Then we have done for the investigation. So the basic investigation, as we have understood, is the X-ray. Plain X-ray and the age of the patient are sufficient to reach to the conclusive diagnosis with confidence in case of bone tumor. Then we have studied about the special investigation like technetium scan. We have studied about the MRI, and we have studied about their importance. So at the end of the lecture, what I intend, you should be familiar with the common term, what is staging, what is grading of the tumor, and what is the Enneking system of classifying this tumor. This will help you to communicate with the patient and with your colleague, and you will have a clear idea what you are dealing with. At the end, we have discussed about the adjuvant therapies and neoadjuvant therapies, and we have discussed about the radiotherapy. And you must have a very clear idea about what is neoadjuvant therapy, what is adjuvant therapy, and what is radiation, and where it is used. Now, in the next lecture, we will discuss about the common tumor. I am not going to discuss everything or all tumor. We will go for the tumor which are commonly asked in the examination, such as osteodystoma, enchondroma, Ewing sarcoma, giant cell tumor. We will discuss about them, their occurrence and their presentation, investigation and their management. Thank you. Dhal.